everyone.
How goes?
Welcome to our D&D one-shot. This is Coven. These are my lovely ladies that you see before you. We're going to play some D&D today, y'all. Welcome. All right, so we're going to just get right on to it. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I see that there's a lot of you in chat, a lot of regulars. Thanks, guys. I hope you enjoy it. I think we're going to have a lot of fun. It's going to be very goofy. And a good foray, I think, for all of us into live streaming D&D, which is something we hope to do on the regular. So let's just kick off right into it. So I'll have the ladies introduce themselves and who they're playing, and then I will introduce myself, and then we will tell you a little bit about this one shot that we're going to be doing. So we can go ahead and
put your hat on.
There we go.
Now we can start.
Hello, everybody. I'm Ashley, and I will be playing Gwendolyn Oakes. She is a sorceress, and she has no right hand, so it's going to be difficult for her to cast some things. But to make up for it, she has a right hand man named Mark. So it'll be a fun game today.
Good. Familiar.
I'm Kalyn. I am playing Ashes Torzalan, who is a tiefling warlock, and he's a big book dweeb.
I'm Shelby. I'll be playing Magpie Zulgduruk, the dwarven cleric, and yeah, she's nasty.
So, I'm Kelsey. I'm going to be playing Jaaldura, the Goliath Blackthorn Shaman. So, 8 foot tall lady.
A homebrew class, right?
What?
You have yes, homebrew?
So, yeah, it's kind class. Of a mix. It's a shaman, paladin, but witchy.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
And I'm going to be playing Molly Barleyfoot, a small halfling wizard. With a affinity for making things.
And you're also Anna. But most people in chat know who you are.
Well,
so that's
it. My real name is Molly Barleyfoot.
So you're going full method on this. Changed it on your birth certificate. Done. Fully Molly now.
Absolutely.
And I am your DM, aka your dark mistress. So this afternoon, my name is Allison. For those of you, obviously, the name's on the channel. You guys have probably been here before. Normally, I stream art, but today we're doing D&D because we always talked about doing it, and that's what we decided to do today. So this is Coven. This is our little foray into the witching world of the town of Watershed. And Watershed is a small town and a very isolated countryside. I have a little intro for you guys. The town of Watershed is nestled deep within the desolate countryside, surrounded by an ever-present shrouding mist and the ominous western woods. It is a town to simple folk who tend to their farms day in and day out, living their lives in fear of what cannot be explained. Every now and again, however, when one is desperate enough, they seek the aid of others who go beyond the natural realm to satiate their woes. Over the bridge, beyond the bog, across the endless fields of prickly tall grass and into the western woods they tread, careful not to step off the path. Once deep within the heart of the forest, they find the hobble. Your hobble. As they have sought the aid of witches. Welcome, one and all, to our D&D one-shot coven.
Yeah.
So just a couple housekeeping things before we get right on into this. So obviously we're playing D&D 5e, but it's a little bit homebrewed. So just for those of you in chat, I love you all dearly, and I understand that maybe some things might come up that we might mess up. It's all good. We're just going to have fun, so don't worry about any rules lawyering. We appreciate it, but it's going to go unheard. So just to get that out of the way quickly. But by all means, interact with the game as much as you so desire. We want you guys, obviously, to be participating and enjoying yourselves. Yeah, I think we can get right on into it. So, you guys have a little bit of background on the town of Watershed itself. Your hobble in the western woods is a small cottage. It's got a single hearth, one living room, an attic, a cellar, a porch, and a barn with one donkey. And that's about it.
Donkey.
Just one donkey. In the
barn. You can if you choose to. Otherwise,
if you have one room, I don't think I'll fit.
That's probably fair. I would think it's a little tight for all of you, but
sleep with the donkey.
Cozy and warm, considering you know you always have the hearth lit. It does have a sense of coziness to it. And you all were brought here for one reason or another. over the course of your life by your matron witch, whose name is Indea. And she is a very old elven woman who has deep tan skin, long, curly, dark brown hair that's graying in places, piercing copper eyes, and actually one of her ears has been halved off. You're not sure why that happened. She doesn't really talk about it very much, but something apparently might have ripped it off at one point in time. She's a bit of a gnarly woman, I would say. She's cryptic, but she's also, she's offered this place to you free of judgment. She's offered you food, offered you shelter, and the tools to harness your craft. So as not warm and fuzzy as she is, she has given you guys a lot as far as a place, you know, as far as a place to live and things you've expected out of your life. Because being inclined toward the witching arts, you all have not felt very in tune with society. You haven't felt a great acceptance from society for whatever reason. But I know that two of you specifically, I think we could touch on this a little bit, two of you specifically came from three of you technically came from other tribes, other herds in a sense, or other communities, but two of you have interest in returning to them, so I think we could, Molly and Magpie could share a little bit about that.
Yeah, so I come from the town of Hogsmeade. It's a small town, really nice people. I kind of live on the outskirts of that. Occasionally people might come to me with, you know, a sick cow or, you know, various ailments, and I offer them, you know, solutions to their problems. So it's pretty straightforward there, you know. They give me, you know, some milk from the recovered cow in payment for that. It's kind of a barter system we have going on.
Yeah, it's a nice A to B.
I miss it actually quite a bit. It's kind of sad. I miss my hearth and my bed and my rooms to myself. That's nice. But you ladies are great, though. I mean, don't worry about it.
Ladies?
Oh, sorry. Sorry, Ashes. I forget. Sorry.
He is quite androgynous, though, so don't make a mistake.
So yeah, that's Hogsmeade.
And then Magpie, you also came from a little bit of a precarious circumstance prior to
arriving. Yes. I grew up in the mountains, my clan. Always in my little cave, full of trinkets and treasures, the hedge witch of the hills. And then one day. This outsider decides to show up and start offering healing services for free. Because, just out of the goodness of his heart, he couldn't stand to see people being charged so much to be well. And he's learned, and all of a sudden everyone starts asking about certification. Where did you go to school? Who taught you how to heal people? Why does this always happen? Like, I don't know why this person came to town, but my whole point is I need to get certified so I can go home and get my cave back and start making a living again.
And then Jaaldura, you came from a bit of a different circumstance where you were actually shunned from your herd. Is this correct?
Yeah, I can't go home. I don't like that I use magic. And they sent me away. So now this is my herd. You're a lot smaller. But that's okay. Especially you.
Oh,
you're very small.
Hi.
Why are you
are
so
you today,
small?
Jaaldura?
No, I'm good.
Oh, good.
But yes, I can't go home. So you should all stay with me.
Yeah. And then Ashes and Gwendolyn, quickly. I know Gwendolyn lived in the town of Watershed prior to becoming part of the Coven. She was actually sort of the inaugural member of Zendaya's Coven, being that she lived in the town of Watershed previously.
Yes. So originally I was a traveler. I'd travel from town to town, selling my trinkets, making my money, moving on. Well, I ended up in this town one day, and some little boy named Mark was digging through my purse. He grabbed out my love potion, thought he was going to fall in love with some girl, and ended up falling in love with me. So now I got stuck with him and his family in the little one hut place again. I just needed to get out. So as soon as Zendaya offered me the position, I was running 200 Coven House. Me and Mark have lived there for a while, and now we're welcoming everybody else in.
And then finally, Ashes, our little outlier, who is, as you mentioned, a book dweeb.
Yes, I'm a book dweeb. Well, I used to live with my grandpa for my whole life, and he's a groundskeeper for a noble family. They live in, like, a town kind of far away, but not that far away, but far away enough. I didn't really know anybody else. There wasn't any other kids, really. So I played by myself, and I read a lot of books, and I met a devil, kind of, when I was little. But he's the nice one. Like, the one nice devil. You know, there's always one, and he's it.
It's perfect. And yes, Zendaya offered you a position to
learn. She said I could learn a lot of new stuff, so I was like, alright, I'll go. And so here I am.
Here you are. So, Zendaya is often absent in your guys' life. She has a little bit of a reclusive lifestyle where she'll pop in every now and again, stay for a couple weeks, and then leave for a couple months, kind of unannounced, and doesn't really tell you where she's going, doesn't really tell you what she's doing. It's pretty much par for the course. She's been gone for about a week at this point, leaving you guys alone to your own devices, and in that sense, she has left you with tasks to be fulfilled, one of which being in going to get supplies from the nearby town of Watershed, which is always a bit of a tenuous circumstance for you all. You like going into town, you like seeing people, obviously, to a certain extent, but you know that there's a bit of a give and take with how people perceive you in Watershed, and it's a little tenuous, to say the least. She's given you instructions as to what to find in town, who to go to, and your main allies in town are the midwife, the barkeeper, and the grave digger. And generally, when you guys go into town, you do find the midwife. She's usually your point of contact. She usually helps you out and helps you get your stores together. Keeps you hidden if need be. Generally tells you the goings on in town, being that she's a bit of a gossip. She knows what's going on, so she keeps you all in loop, and she's also very good friends with Zendaya, so she generally knows where she is and what she's doing. So Zendaya has given you this task to go into town the following morning. It is evening at this point. You guys are all kind of settling into bed. Has given you the task to go into town to get these supplies. So as you guys are resting for the evening, you have a peaceful rest. Jaaldura is in the barn. The rest of you are, you're sleeping with a dog. What's the donkey's name, Jaaldura?
Oh, that's a good question.
Since you guys probably cozy up, I would think. He probably sleeps because it's warmer.
My donkey's name is Ipo.
Ipo? Ipo the donkey?
Yeah. Solid name.
I like Ipo. It. He just kind of brays at you gently and then goes back to sleep. So Jaaldura is out in the barn. You all are settling in for the evening, sleeping around the hearth as you often do. Mark is kind of off to the side.
Where does he sleep?
I try to push him away, but he just keeps spooning me.
Yeah, he gets closer and closer as the evening progresses.
Every time I wake up, I feel suffocated.
Unsolicited spooning.
I've gotten used to it. I just sleep with less blankets now.
Yeah, it's a little hotter. You guys always have the hearth burning sort of low throughout the evening, keeping you guys pretty cozy. It's, you know, you all gotten used to it. Some of you have been here for a year, some of you have been here for about 3 months to 6 months, but you all have gotten pretty used to each other by this point, and even could stand to call each other friends in certain instances. Maybe not between Ashes and Magpie, but we're working on that. So as you all settle in for slumber for the evening. It's about the middle of the night. It's about 2 in the morning. You guys have been sleeping for some time, and Molly, you bolt upright from the dead of slumber, and a premonition has been surging through you as you dreamt, and all of you have been found yourselves bound to this as you were sleeping. So the rest of you are kind of stirring quietly from your slumber as Molly bolts upright. This is not entirely uncommon, but in your experience, this has been you and you alone. You've had dreams before where they have been premonitions of some kind, being that you do have a bit of a fate-touched aspect to your magic. You do have a little bit of a seer in you, as it were. based on your connections to the threads of magic. And so you have had experiences before where you have woken up startled due to dreams that you've had, but you've never had it happen where the rest of your coven has been connected to these. The thing is, though, all of you have experienced something different, and so I need you all to roll initiative for me real quick.
First roll of the day.
Uh-huh.
Let's see if I remember. And here we go.
Oh, did you get a cool fail?
Yay!
Starting off strong, Kelsey. I like it.
Who do you want to start?
Whoever got the highest, so.
Oh, well, I went around the table.
Oh, around the table, doesn't matter.
I got an 18.
18?
11.
I have a 7.
11.
I got a 2.
Oh my goodness, guys. I love it. Okay, that's okay.
Almost.
I got a 2.
So based on these, initiative rolls, you guys have all seen different omens, different premonitions in the middle of the night. And so Molly, you to start off, you saw in your dreams, you saw two small children holding hands.
Aww.
You can surmise a brother and a sister, and they were both wreathed in a bright light.
Oh.
Slightly ominous, perhaps.
Wreathed in a bright light. There wasn't any other details. There wasn't a place.
There could have been. I think where they were, they looked like they might have been in the woods somewhere.
Okay.
It was a little hazy, a little hard to distinguish, but it looked they were indiscriminate with their features. You saw their silhouettes against this bright light, so they weren't entirely sure. They looked younger though. A girl and a boy. Yep. You can gather based on their similar sort of body type, their similar bone structure, the details you could make out about them. They looked like they might have been related, and they looked like they might have been roughly 10 to 13. The brother might have been a little younger, but you're not entirely sure. That's about as much detail as you can gather from them. Do you have any other questions as far as the premonition is concerned?
Let's see, location, they're wreathed in a bright light. Did it have a specific color, or was it just kind of like...
It's white light.
White. Oh, white light. Okay. Mm-hmm. Were they going anywhere?
They were standing, they were looking at you.
Creepy.
Come play with us. Yeah,
basically. Yeah.
I think that's all I have.
Okay. This is actually a good one for you, Shelby, because I think you'll appreciate this. Your other character will appreciate this. You saw in this precognitive dream, you saw a wolf furiously digging deep into the earth, and something was clenched in his bared teeth. And that something was a dangling eye, an eyeball, essentially looks like it was ripped from somebody's head.
Rad. was this in like a forest, or did I just see like...
This actually looks close to a forest. You actually do recognize the location. It was, you've been there before. I think I will have you roll a history check to see if you can distinguish exactly where it was, but you know you've been there before.
13?
This was around the graveyard.
Ooh, shit. Oh, could I have gotten a specific location?
I
just got the woods.
You can go ahead and do it if you want a history check. Go for it. We can work on it a little bit.
History is 8.
8. Hard to say. Yeah, I mean, there's a wood surrounding the entirety of the town. It seemed familiar to you, but you've also seen woods for the better part of the last year.
Okay. That's fine.
Next up was Ashes. So, Ashes, you saw three birds perched on a low-hanging branch. One was red, one was gold, one was black. They were all singing discordantly together.
Do I know what kind of birds?
They looked like, what's the normal red one? Is it a robin? Not a robin.
Cardinal?
Cardinal. That's what I'm looking for. One was a cardinal. The gold one looks like it might have been a finch, and the black one looks like it was a crow.
Let's see.
The finch definitely looked oddly gold. I would say not naturally gold.
Was he sparkly?
A little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Oh, wow. Yes. If you would like to distinguish anything else about the location or anything.
Is this somewhere I recognize?
Go ahead and roll a history check.
I don't know how to do that.
Okay, so you have history on your abilities.
Roll d20 and then you'll add or subtract whatever. Oh, dang.
Did she get a good history?
Yeah.
Let's see, 12.
She is a bit of a nerd.
16? You definitely recognize the location as one of the paths leading out of town into the immediate woods. So, not the western woods where you guys are located. It might be on the northern side or the eastern side. You're not 100% sure, but it looks like it's very close to town. And then, Gwendolyn, you find, and you're in this dream of yours, you see a single green bud blooming in the earth covered by a light snowfall, which is strange at this time of year, being that it is, you guys are basically in, like, late fall at this point. It's not quite cold enough to be snowy. You live in a climate more bog-like climate where it's
temperate.
It's not uncommon to see snow, but it would be very infrequent, and it would be very, very much in the dead of winter. Not quite yet, so it seems a little early for something like that.
Do I recognize where it's located?
You can go ahead and roll me a nature check, because it is surrounded by greenery at this point. It's surrounded by woods, as far as you can tell.
19?
Mm-hmm. It looks like you could discern that it is, in the woods, not your guys' immediate area, but it looks like it could be, it's hard to say just because it is just a lot of trees, but it does look like it is in the same type of trees that are surrounding the town, probably not as far off as you guys are located.
Do I recognize the flower?
It just looks like it hasn't even bloomed yet. It's just a tiny little stem.
I don't recognize what kind of plant.
No.
Okay.
Not necessarily.
That's fine.
Have I had these premonitions while staying with them before?
You've had a couple. You've had, they've been pretty nondescript as far as, like, so different premonitions that you've had previously. You might have dreamt about a certain problem, like maybe, you know, as you mentioned, maybe somebody's cow got sick or something, and you dreamt of a cow sleeping and making awful noises, and then the following day, a man would come to the coven store asking for help to heal his sick cow. So in certain instances, you have had these dreams where something has come to fruition as a result of them the following day.
Guys, I know it's early, but I actually had another dream again. It was troubling. Do you want to hear about it?
Yeah.
Can we say no?
And we will get to that just right quick, though, because Miss Barn, you also experienced this.
Oh, that's right.
The barn. Sorry. You're in the barn. I'm not used to
it. It actually works out really well, because like, you would not have known that she was experiencing anything. So in the barn, you and Ipo wake up.
Start off. Doesn't Ipo have a dream?
He might have had a dream.
So
probably wasn't
panics.
About
like
this.
A cat does when it has a dream.
Yeah, he's just
kicking me,
twitching. Yeah, Ipo startles awake because you startle awake, and I need you. I need you to roll me a
d4.
I
love it. Oh, shit.
Okay. Here we go. You got the best one. I'm so.
Oh, excited. I rolled a one.
You rolled a one. You see Gwendolyn, misshapen, grotesque, this dark energy coming off of her. And she's got this, you can feel the power, like, seething off of her, and she looks triumphant, and she looks fierce, and she looks dangerous. With a missing hand, just the one hand.
I want to reach for my weapon and grab Beepo's leg by mistake.
He kind of just squeals really quickly and kicks out at you. I actually need to roll me a dexter. Oh, I think he hit you.
Oh, no. That's 15.
15, you got a 17, so Ipo very quickly just strikes you in the side with the back of his foot and brays violently and kind of gets up and trots away.
What was that?
You guys do hear a commotion from the barn. You hear Ipo bray very, very loudly and just kind of like a crashing bucket and like...
Jaaldura?
I'm fine.
Okay.
I'll go in. Do I fit in the door?
You do, yeah.
Okay, I'll go again.
It's a little narrow. It's tall enough for you, certainly.
Okay.
You kind of have to, like, shimmy your way
through. Go sideways in. Okay. I'll go in. Because I'm awake now.
Yes. So I had another dream, like, before... When the one guy came with his cow.
Right.
Except,
I remember that one.
Yeah. It was different this time. I mean, it wasn't super clear. I saw two kids in the woods, bathed in this kind of white light, and that they were looking at me.
Like, nicely?
Was it nicely?
It was eerie, but it wasn't. It gave you a bit of an uncomfortable sense.
It was unsettling.
Children.
And I usually like children. It's not usually you guys. You don't like children.
Well, what kind of children?
Well, you're kind of a kid anyway.
No, I mean kind of children? Like,
only when
they're
when they want
children?
Something in the parents'
body.
They
were human, right?
They were human.
They were they were human. I guess.
They are creepy. Those ones are.
Anyway, I'm not sure what to make of that yet. We can kind of just wait and see.
Yeah. It's like 2 a.m. We have to, like, get up very soon. Don't we have to go do something in the morning?
Yeah, we have to go into town. What do we have to do again?
You have to go and get supplies from town.
Yes.
Yeah.
A care package.
I'm going to sleep until the morning, and I just roll over.
Nightmare.
I'm watching Gwen, and I'm, like, looking her over. I'm like, she looks normal proportions.
Normal proportions.
Well, that sounds like a good idea. I'm going to go find Ipo.
What are you doing?
What? Well, I woke up because I grabbed Ipo's leg and he didn't like that
very
much.
Well, Chris, not. He's a donkey.
No, I mean, why were you, like, looking at Gwen?
Oh, well, I might have had a dream, too.
Really?
Yeah.
Was it?
Well, it was Gwen, but she wasn't Gwen. She was, like, kind of deformed and... one arm was way bigger than the other one, and she looked all distended, and you looked weird.
I, like, roll over, I'm like, that sounds like a nightmare.
It was. Oh, sounds cool. Sounds, well.
Yeah.
What, so I came in to make sure she still had two arms that were normal sized, and, because you said my name.
Yeah.
Oh no, I'm missing my hand.
That
it's almost normal size.
That's very funny.
I've come to find a lot of power in dreams, so maybe...
I mean we all have weird dreams. I had a weird dream about a wolf with a dangly eyeball digging in the graveyard, but I mean, what does that even mean?
Can I, like, draw any conclusions from dreams?
You certainly could try.
Having a history with this? Does this ring any...
You can choose to roll history or arcana. You might get different things depending on what you decide to roll.
I'm gonna go with arcana, because that's higher. Oh, I did good.
You did.
24.
Ooh. Okay, I'm gonna whisper it to you.
Oh. Try not to knock over all the candles.
Whispers.
Okay. Oh my god.
I can come here. Let's talk more about Ipo. He's the most exciting character in this game. Is that donkey?
Does a donkey have a dream?
Oh, I don't know.
You didn't ask.
I didn't ask him.
Well, why not? That's
weird. I thought you were close.
Well,
welcome up.
We kind of have a one-sided friendship.
I didn't get anything from her.
No.
Okay. You said it was an eyeball.
Yes.
Carried by what, exactly?
A wolf. It was dangling. And...
How much do you all know about hags?
Not much.
I got a lot of books about hags.
I've got stories on the room.
So the eye, occasionally they'll, take body parts and use them as, it's called a seeing eye. They can see through the eye.
It was a wolf, though.
Yeah, that's the idea. Is they have their things, their familiars, like Mark, for example, or Benny, right?
Beasley.
Sorry.
Did you
Beasley.
Well, it's Beasley.
I didn't, but I will now because he's gonna wake up, and I touch my necklace.
Oh God!
And I summon my favorite familiar that has ever existed in the entire world. Beasley, the sentient skull.
Mm. And he apparates. You see this plume of smoke come from Ash's necklace and kind of coalesce into this skull shape. It's actually a skull on the table, too. I didn't notice that.
Yeah.
There he is. Hold him up.
So Beasley isn't a human skull. He looks like he's some kind of amalgamation of a small rodent skull, a bird skull, and a human skull. So he's got a little bit of an interesting flair going on with him.
Isn't he great?
Yeah.
He's like, oh, Ashes, how are you doing?
Hey! Sorry I woke you up. We got weird stuff happening, and so I thought maybe if you were here, you could help out.
Sure, I think I could help. What do you need?
Okay, so we got, like, some weird dreams going on. Like, something about Gwen being, like, a monster, but not one I've heard of. And then something about a wolf with an eyeball, which apparently has something to do with a hag. I don't know about that either.
It probably does. I think it does.
Does it? But I had a dream about birds. How, you know... That doesn't seem very hag-like. There was three birds, and one was black, and one was red, and one was, like, shimmery gold.
Hags come in threes sometimes.
I mean...
Maybe they're hags.
But they look nice.
Oh, that's true. So anyway, the seeing eye, the wolf could be a familiar. It's so they can spy. Mm-hmm. Do you know where it was? Did you say the graveyard?
It was in the graveyard.
Did it look like Watershed's graveyard?
Think so.
We're going into town today.
We could have talked to the grave digger.
Exactly. Let's get some sleep now.
We're all
cranky at 2 a.m.
Especially when I don't get my sleep. And Mok's been extra snuggly tonight.
He just kind of like, you feel a hand just kind of like reach.
I know how that goes.
Away, Mok. Away.
I'm sorry. You're like a hoof print right
here. A hoof print on my face. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I woke Beasley up and everything. Like, we don't know anything else. Like, dreams. Gwen, did you have a dream?
Yes. I want to get back to it.
Oh, it was good.
It was all right. It was like a bud in the forest, like around here somewhere, covered in snow.
A bud?
Like
a
plant? Like a plant. Not quite flowered yet. Just growing.
It was snow?
I guess.
Kind of early for snow, don't you think?
Seemed calming, though. Way better than what's happening here.
But we're having a good time, aren't we? It's kind of like a sleepover, because Jaaldura came over, so... And Beasley's here.
But this is, like, the first time we need to do something in the morning for a very long time now. And I'd love to be rested. So let's go back to bed.
I gotta go find Ipo.
Where did Ipo go?
Well, we had to fight.
You're
a fight. We had a fight. I have print on my face.
So, Jaaldura, as you exit from the conversation, I'm going to have you go ahead and roll an animal handling check.
Am I good at this?
Am I good at wrangling the donkey?
Ooh,
18. 18, yes. Yeah, there's some corralling involved. He kind of skirts away from you a couple times, but you manage to kind of, like, position him so he runs back into the barn.
I'm sorry. I said I was sorry.
Oh, Ipo.
No, it's perfect. So you all settle down back for the evening. Beasley hangs out for a little bit.
And... Me, I just hold Beasley.
Yeah.
Is he on fire?
I like fire.
Oh.
I don't think he's a flame.
Kind of my.
I pictured him.
He
as
He has
like
a little
flame,
bit.
So.
I mean, he's got an essence surrounding him. I wouldn't say that it's like tangible flame, but he's got a little bit of a fiery essence to him, as for lack of a better term.
You know, it's kind of my thing.
Donkeys are your thing.
Donkeys are my thing.
So the following morning, you all wake up, and trying to get my music going here. You wake up. And Jaaldura wakes up a little bit earlier than the rest of you do, has Ipo tacked up to the cart, ready to go, has all of his equipment. And it's just a simple cart, simple wooden cart, and he's a little bit of a smaller donkey, but he knows what his job is. So you're standing out there ready to go. You all can have a quick breakfast or anything you'd like to do before you depart towards town.
I have a full 2 breakfasts before I go.
What about second breakfast?
That was the second breakfast. Obviously, we have a big day. You have to eat up.
That's true.
And I have some stuff for the road. I've got some trail mix and some French bread and some cheese that we can cut on the way. I know it's only a 10-minute walk, but you know.
Right.
Ready?
It's a 10-minute walk.
It's about 2 miles, so it's not very far. It's about 2 miles, so it's maybe like 20-30 minutes.
Yeah, that sounds good.
Let's go. I just start walking with Mark. towards town.
He just follows obediently. So this is a good time to introduce this. We didn't introduce it with Beasley last night just because he was only out for a little bit, but I would like you to roll me a d6, Gwendolyn.
Six.
Perfect. So Mark seems like incredibly loyal today, like and to the point where he you're not sure kind of what his deal is at the moment, but he seems like vigilant, almost like he is like looking around very, very actively. He heard all the conversations you guys were having the previous
day.
He
is a person, so I
guess
it makes
sense. Yeah. He seems like he's being very protective, almost like he is trying to he's assessing your surroundings, he's trying to scout ahead a little bit. He's not a fighter, he's just some guy from town, so I mean this is kind of comical to watch him run around with no weapons.
He's like,
hands.
Just... That's exactly what I was thinking of. Da-da-da!
You see him kind of, like, dart into the woods for a little bit and come back out, and, like, he's kind of doing that zigzag run in front of you guys, like, to the point where he is almost tuckering himself out, but he is...
What are you doing?
Is he okay?
I have no idea. Mark, get over here and stay put.
He listens very obediently.
He'll tire for later. He'll wear himself out for later.
Oh, that's worse, because then when I need something, he's not around. Mark, get over here.
I'm sorry. He comes over very obediently and stands by your side. He's like, I just wanted to make sure that nothing was gonna pop out at us.
Oh,
we had
sweet
dreams. It wasn't anything here. I'm sure we'll be okay.
But sometimes they do mean things are there.
I just, see?
Don't rile Mark up.
But I mean, it's true. I don't want to lie to him.
Darling, if I'm supposed to be your right-hand man, I have to protect you.
Oh my gosh.
Darling.
Protect me next to me without wearing yourself out. Just be extra eyes and ears, that's all I ask.
Okay.
Did you have a dream too?
No.
Well,
I don't.
That's good.
I just dream of you.
That's lovely. Let's go.
So you guys continue on your trek into town. Love it. You continue on your trek into town. Who is taking point? Generally, you guys have a bit of a system going into town.
That's true.
But I'm going to walk next to Ebo because we had a bit of a tiff left.
So you guys are coming back. That's
is he pretty loyal to me today too?
He seems like, I mean, you fed him a couple carrots. You fed him some bran in the morning. He seems like he's a donkey. So he's a little bit obstinate in general, but yeah. He seems like he's cooperating.
Connect.
who has the highest survival? Are we taking like point?
Yeah, it's a point person.
So. On proficient.
I have +3.
Me too.
I only have +1.
Same.
Well, if I'm up by the donkey, you want to go? You go ahead. You scout ahead, Magpie.
Fine. So you guys are... So being that Magpie is taking point, and she is a dwarf, and she and Molly both have little teeny itty bitty baby steps, you guys are heading into town at a slow pace. You've gotten accustomed to it.
Just for reference, how many of my steps equal one of Molly's steps?
I think three is the right
answer. I was going to say 8. She's like, ding, ding, ding.
I hope it's like you step, wait.
Step wait.
You kind of just do heel-toe.
Heel-toe.
Bridle walk all the way.
You take two forward, one back.
Yeah. Just so I don't get bored.
You and Ebo meanderly. Like, you give Ebo a couple grazing breaks and then kind of leisurely catch up to the group, so it works itself out.
It's the usual routine when we go into town.
So, Magpie, you're familiar, you usually are the point person with the midwife as well. What is the midwife's name? You're aware, you have a fairly friendly relationship with her, so.
What's her name? Amelia.
Amelia, okay. Amelia the midwife. So Amelia has always been sort of your liaison into town. She's been, as far as you can tell, she's been friends with Zendaya since she arrived. She's always been very forthcoming to all of you. She doesn't seem to have the same stigmas associated with you that the rest of the townspeople do. She regards you as any other person, and regards your magical inclinations passively. She doesn't seem to mind one way or the other. So Amelia generally leaves you a sign to let you know if she's afoot. She is expecting you, so go ahead and roll me, I would say, a perception check in this case.
16.
So you do notice there is a swath of cloth, like a strip of fabric, essentially tied to one of the tree in a bow, which is generally your indication that she is around. And so now I will have you roll a survival check to see if you can navigate your way to the cellar of her husband's establishment without...
Seven.
So...
We kick the door into the bar and be like, we here to party!
So what's Magpie distracted with where she wouldn't necessarily be concerned about what's going on?
She found a coin.
She found a coin?
On the walkway and is just like...
So she's kind of like a kid on her cell phone, where she's just like kind of walking, like meandering toward the woods, where you guys are like, you guys are all hanging back a little bit, and you're like, that's wait, what? Like, you know that this isn't quite right. Where she's meandering a little toward the left.
Magpie, come back.
Maybe she's taking us a secret way.
I dig a gold out.
So.
Wait, I gotta go this way. I dig a gold out. Magpie, come on, back on track. Come on, I'll give it to you if you lead us.
Just snatches it. It's back on track.
Yeah, how many like dangly bits has she brought with her? Both of you, actually. How many like
as many as possible.
As many as possible. So I would say for future reference, and how dangly are you at the moment? How much...
I'm not super dangly, it's like general like
she has to hire her dangly like shiny bits from me. So she needs to always keep that.
Most,
that's true.
Most of the things I have on me are things she can't snatch easily. Like earrings. And then necklace, and then, like, my arm thing. And then I've got my wand, which is in my chest, so that she doesn't feel tempted to snag it out of my back pocket or anything.
I'm going for that.
Wait, no. Pry it off of your dead corpse.
You have, like, a gold cap?
Yeah. So after I got all the dragon's gold, I made a gold cap and put a big old ruby I found in his cave.
So paste it there, too.
Alright.
No. Mine.
We'll see.
So I would say for future reference, Magpie, you absolutely have disadvantage on stealth checks.
Okay.
Because you are jingling and jangling as you are rolling down the hill. You've got, like, do you see a little pep in her step after she's gotten this old from
jingling and jangling?
She's kind of just, like, bopping down this hill a little bit
faster.
Does
this affect her AC? Like, it's essentially chainmail at this point.
That's an interesting, what's your AC currently? That's an interesting
13.
Point. 13? I feel like 13's fairly high, but we'll see. It might be a certain circumstance where you have a little bit of cover. You have a little bit of self-cover happening.
I like the image of her jangling. Because I picture Magpie as just as wide as she is tall. Like, yeah, basically. Like
she's a square.
She's just a square of a person. Yeah.
Terrifying. That's exactly square.
So I would say after you've had this little bit of a distraction, you can sort of reset. So go ahead and roll another survival check.
Even more distracted by the gold coins.
Maybe we should just have Epo lead.
I know where we're going, right?
Yeah, sure. You can try to assist her if you'd like.
I would like to assist. Magpie.
Yes.
Never mind, I'll do it myself.
No. Another one?
This is not going well.
Is this Wally trying to reach a doorknob?
D&D workshop. The witches never make it to town.
Just get lost in
what
the
are
woods.
You fools doing up there? Jeez.
No, at this point, what happens is, Magpie has, like, scuttled down the hill, and Molly goes to reach her, and these two kind of, like, skid. Like, it's rained recently, so they kind of, like, skid a bit of mud. And kind of, like, she kind of, like trips and stumbles kind of wrapped up in the train of cloth that follows you. Both of you kind of like eat shit subsequently into the mud and start kind of bickering with one another, trying to get back up on
what was that all about?
Can I go down and pick
what are
them
you talking
up?
About?
Yeah, so we're all gonna spell check.
Okay. Let me down! This is undignified!
Oh shit.
We're all doing so bad.
Nine. I even chose a different die. Okay. I had a nine. I can pick
that. Yeah, you pick Molly up quite easily.
Stop it!
Kind of like a cat, but
this
a scruff of her neck.
Undignified. What are you doing, Jaaldura? Put me down.
Well, you're fighting, and we gotta get to town before...
Before we all die.
She would focus for more than a half a second on anything other than a piece of gold.
I'm going.
As you guys are doing this, you two notice off to the side that there are townsfolk. That there's not very many at this early hour, but you do see some townsfolk kind of like looking over toward the woods. You guys are luckily kind of obscured by a little bit of that still like morning mist that's still surrounding the town, so they can't quite see you. They just hear essentially like cats coming from close to the forest, and you do see them kind of like peering around. One gentleman actually like kind of like slaps another on the shoulder and is like pointing, and it looks like they're going to start coming over in your direction.
Guys, wrap your stuff together. Let's go.
we gotta go, like, in the town. Can we go
in?
Because they're looking over here, like, you know.
She pockets her penny and her gold coin.
They already think bad of us enough. Let's go.
So I would say that the three that have not rolled a survival check can go ahead and roll
a survival check. It's
Molly and
it's a Magpie, right?
Let's see.
Yeah, okay. And then you add your survival.
I'm gonna, no, you know what? We'll do this one.
16.
I got a 12.
Okay, great.
I've got a mouth on me.
Okay.
That's a 9.
Okay, well, you know, Gwendolyn just kind of, like, Gwendolyn and Ash is kind of, like, arm in arm almost, just kind of lead forward, assuming you all are going to follow, kind of not really caring if you do or don't at this point. They're getting out, and they're going, they're
yeah,
kind of ready to go.
Time to go.
I'm too dense to lift. Somehow you look even smaller when you're angry.
Stop it!
Sorry.
She, like, straightens her jacket and brushes herself off after you put her down and just kind of, like, stomps away,
squishing in the mud as you go. So, you two come upon the cellar doors first. Subsequently, how this brewery is laid out. Amelia's husband owns a bar. He owns, like, a brewery and does a lot of food stuff and has the only one in town. And the way they have generally led you in is essentially imagine a hill, but sort of that divot where you can see a little bit of the basement, like mm-hmm. the foundation of the house, essentially. And there is a makeshift door that has been created down there for you, but there's also a handshake involved. So, Gwendolyn, do you remember the handshake?
I sure do.
You sure do?
But I just can't
do
it.
It's essentially a knock. I shouldn't say handshake. It's a knock, essentially, to make sure that it's you guys.
Thunk, thunk, thunk.
I, like, kind of wish you had a golden hand that was just permanently, like, a middle finger. I feel like that would be Gwendolyn. Like.
I'll get one made. I feel like I need one of those now. I walk up and I do a little rap, like, tunk, 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 tunk.
Okay. So, like, a short, long, short,
yep.
sort of thing? All right.
There you go.
A couple seconds pass. You guys are still very aware that there are voices. You can actually see the men that kind of came down the hill. One actually slips on the sort of the mud streak that you guys had created in your fray. And actually falls down and is like, shit, and, like, you know, picks himself back up. The two of them are looking around for a minute, but both of them seem a little unnerved that there is so much mist still surrounding the town. And for our audience, I guess I didn't preface that for you guys either, that there's an ever-present mist surrounding the town of Watershed, and the townsfolk are very fearful and very superstitious of it. The witch is a little less so. You guys know that things could lurk potentially in shrouded cover like that, but you also use it to your advantage. A couple seconds pass by, and then you see a smaller human woman open the door. She's in a general, like, beige, a nice beige dress, nothing super fancy. She's got red curly hair, a very pleasant face, bright blue eyes, and she kind of opens the door. She goes, "Oh, that's as I thought you weren't going to ever make it."
The way this morning's going, I thought the same.
She kind of looks out for a second, and then she sees the two men that are still kind of, like, putzing around the car. She goes, come in, quickly. Wash your head, Jaaldura. You can leave Ipo outside. He'll be fine.
I press the digitation myself, like, get all the mud off of me.
She, Amelia very much appreciates that as you come in. She goes, and she kind of looks at you. Those of you that forget to take your shoes off sometimes, she kind of, Jaaldura specifically, she kind of just eyes you very, very quickly, patiently.
What? She eyes me.
Mm-hmm.
You haven't taken...
Take your shoes off.
Your shoes.
Like, I've never been inside anything other than a barn before. I'm going to also try and press the digitation magpie. Just not anything extreme, just enough to, like, get the mud off of her that she was rolling around in.
Yeah.
That we were rolling around.
Boop. Boop. And set.
Thank you.
You look better.
I cleaned the shiny off for you, too. It's extra sparkly.
That's a friend.
You're sweet.
You're a sweet one.
I try.
Stop.
Yeah. I love it. Amelia invites you in. There is a hearthlit. This sort of cellar area they have retrofitted to essentially be sort of a den. This seems like a sort of meeting place. And from the stories you've heard from Amelia, some from Zendaya as well, this is sort of a It is a little bit of a, it's got a little bit of a safe house vibe to it. They take guests down here that aren't necessarily welcomed in the bar up top, but it is still made very cozy for you guys to sort of sit and hang out in, because generally the way that these things go is you guys give Amelia a list. Generally one or two of you might assist. Gwendolyn generally is the one to assist just because she fits in with the community the most easily without being noticed. But you would generally spend, you know, a good afternoon here on most occasions, where you would hang out, you would enjoy the fire, you'd enjoy some warmth, you'd talk with her husband. Ashes, you remember her husband's name. You've had quite a few conversations with the
bartender.
Yeah,
he's a cool dude. His name is Gregory.
Gregory the barkeeper.
I just like to call him Greg, though, because we're close.
Yeah, you guys are close. You guys are friends. Yeah, and he's a taller gentleman, generally clean-shaven, but it's always a little bit of, like, 5 o'clock shadow, and he's got kind of that, like, very straight, kind of almost a little stringy, long enough blonde hair where you can put it into, like, a little bit of a ponytail sometimes. But he's a generally very friendly man to all of you, and he seems, unlike Amelia, he doesn't seem very passive to you guys. He almost seems sympathetic, like, he feels bad about how people treat you in town, and for whatever reason, you're not sure why he is that way, but he's always been very sympathetic. He's always been very eager to help you guys, you know, feel comfortable, feel welcome as best as he can. He would love to invite you up to the bar and kind of say screw everybody, but he also understands that he has a business to run. So that's been a bit of a tenuous topic for him. So Amelia invites you in, as you sit down, offers you a crust of bread, some cheese, some crackers.
Ooh, yes, please.
And she takes the list from.
Molly brought trail mix if you want, Amelia.
Yeah, do you want any?
I think I'm fine, but thank you, dear. I might have some later.
I added extra crickets too. Fine.
who's got a list for me today?
Oh, here you go.
Thank you. She kind of looks at it.
Yeah, it's all out of the.
So I saw you might have attracted some attention back there.
No.
I think it's because I'm blue, to be honest.
I don't know that was the reason. I think you all want to be a bit more careful today. The town's been quite jumpy since last night.
What happened last night?
These things!
You sent Donkey for a run around the town is what you did.
Where's my donkey?
He's outside, dear.
He's outside. He's out. You scared me.
He goes fine. The town's been a bit on edge lately, and that's why I was fearful when you hadn't arrived on time. I was afraid something
what?
Might be going on.
What happened?
The baker girl's gone missing. You guess. You might have heard of this girl. What's the baker girl's name?
The baker girl's name is Emily.
Emily and Amelia.
I'm not very creative. Emily and Amelia.
So Emily she explains that Emily Baker has gone missing.
How old is Emily?
Oh, she's about 12. She's a small thing.
Clarification. Is she a girl who is a baker, or is she one of the baker girls?
Her last name is Baker.
Got it.
Her family also bakes, so both.
Wow.
That's where that came from.
That's exactly where it came from.
I love it. Does that mean I oak?
You, sure.
It's a verb now.
And Ash is Torzalans.
You know, it's one of my things.
Oh, so she's just a wee thing.
She is. Yes, I found out after the fact, and it's terrible. I mean, everybody's all in a tizzy about it.
She used to give me bread.
Where did they see her last?
Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. I don't believe anybody saw her leave, but they found, this is crude of me to say, but they found her nightdress on the edge of town, and tracks leading out.
What kind of tracks?
Footprints.
How many did it look like?
Just hers.
Just hers?
It looks like the poor girl, something happened to her and she walked off into the woods naked.
In the middle of the night?
Yes.
But was her dress torn or just left?
Just left, as far as we can tell.
Did she
get
bring anything
look at
to
it,
her but... house? Like, did she pack anything?
I don't know, I haven't asked her folks. I've just heard about it just recently.
What happened when we followed the tracks? Did they find anything?
Oh, I'm not sure, I haven't talked to the constable either. I imagine he's getting a search party together.
Oh, good. I'm gonna talk to him.
The mists haven't cleared yet, so they haven't gone out yet, but I imagine he is getting something together to go look for her. She, as far as we could tell, as far as I've heard, she left in the middle of the night.
So, but last night?
Last night, yes. Quite early in the morning, I would assume.
Did she ever talk about leaving? Did she ever
But was there anything amiss with her? Do you know?
I didn't have much interaction with herself, but I talked to her mother every now and again. I mean, I delivered the child. I've known her since she was a wee thing, but her mother seemed like nothing bad was happening, as far as I could tell. But she's the only interaction I've had. Maybe her mother didn't know.
Do you think we could find her?
Oh yeah,
maybe.
We could try.
We can find her.
I think we could help.
Yeah.
Try and find her. I mean, if the constable's waiting for the mists, I mean, we traveled through them today.
It's still dangerous out there, though.
It's always going to be dangerous.
No, I asked too, because I mean, I wanted to follow up. Have you heard from Zendaya lately?
She left. How long ago did she
leave? A week.
She left a week ago. Seemed like a routine trip.
I did, but I haven't heard from her in a few days, and normally she checks in with me. She hasn't left any sort of messages for any of you.
Really?
Maybe she.
I don't want to alarm anybody.
Enter.
Normally she checks in.
I don't know if you should joke about that, actually.
Oh, sorry.
That's a thing.
Humor's new to me. Practicing with it.
I pat your, like, knee.
Blink, blink, blink.
Before we get too far, we should probably go talk to the constable. I'm sure he will just be so over the moon. We've got to find out what he knows. I know we hate talking to him.
I think he hates talking to us.
Do you think he would talk to us?
I haven't an earthly idea.
I'll put my hood on, it'll be better.
Would their parents talk to us?
I had no earthly idea. I mean, it's difficult for me to say. Obviously, I know you all have the best intentions at heart, but I don't know that they would be as forthcoming. I mean, they're suspicious right now. They don't know what happened to her. I worry that if you all were to get involved, that something might happen to you.
Yeah.
And I'm trying to think of what Zendaya would want here. I don't think she'd want you to get involved.
But she's not here, so...
She's not, but she still wants me to look after you while she's in her absence.
You know... Have I ever told you guys why I'm here in the first place?
Story time.
No.
No?
well, it's because this whole dream thing, this whole, you know, seeing things, is kind of, it's happened a few times before, obviously. And I saw something going on with this town. That's why I'm here, that's why I'm staying with Zendaya in the first place. And, you know, I can't just not do something about this. I think we should try and find her. And not hearing from Zendaya obviously worries me.
It worries me as well. I think something's going on.
I think just waiting and trying to see what happens is not a great idea.
Yeah. What? We can do this.
Yeah.
It's just one girl.
So you said nobody saw her actually leave. They just saw the trail and...
I don't think so. Her parents are mortified. I don't think that they were asleep. I'm not sure if anybody did.
Well...
Which way did she go out of town?
She left east, out of town.
Shall we go talk to the constable and the parents, then?
I suppose we should try.
Let's do the parents and then the constable, because he's probably out trail searching anyways.
Yeah. Do you have any could you come with us?
Me?
Yeah, because, I mean...
She does babies, not missing babies.
That's true, but they know her more than they know us. And if she is with us, they might not turn us away as quickly.
I don't mean to be rude in this, but we've tried to keep this relationship sort of...
Oh, that's right.
Hush, hush, due to the fact that my husband owns a business here. If
Greg.
If something were to happen, and I'm not saying I don't want to help, I don't know if that would be the best thing for me to get myself involved in.
I'm sure, since we're trying to help, they'll be thankful for any help.
Right, of course.
Even if it's us. But they should be happy for us, because we've got extra tools.
They know you, right? Or at least of you?
Yes, I've been in the town for a while. I've seen them around town together too.
You're
well, maybe
human.
we'll put her near the front, and then me, and then you three can just be like way in the back.
That's fine. I want to talk to that constable. He's awful.
But I'm really good at talking to people. I feel like people really trust me.
You're also blue.
I think it's the blue thing.
But sometimes people are just blue.
Sometimes they are, little one. Well, sometimes they are.
Thank you so much for letting us know what happened last night.
Of course, if you need anything else, obviously, you know where to find me.
Yes, and if you hear anything, please let us know.
I will.
Thank you.
To the constable.
No, to the parents, and then the constable.
To the parents!
As you guys are kind of heading back out the door, she stops you for a second. She goes, do you still want me to get the food?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, please.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, it might take a bit longer because I'm by myself, but...
We'll come back for it. It's okay.
We'll be back in a bit. Don't worry.
Be careful, please. Don't get yourselves into anything in over your heads.
Of course not. Me.
We'll be fine.
So you guys head outside. She looks very reluctant as you leave. But you head out into the open field. It looks like those two men have left. We see muddy footprints in the distance. The mist is starting to clear a little bit. Slowly but surely, it seems to be burning off. What sunlight you imagine might be there, and not that you've seen it very much. This is it's got a very Seattle vibe to it, where it is very, very rainy and misty a lot of the time. So let's see if any of you actually know where to find the constable. I don't know that you ever would have frequented his establishment.
Yeah, probably. I feel like not. You probably have the best chance if you spend.
Yeah. Important question. What is a constable?
He keeps it civil around town. Gets rid of any hoodlums.
I think we're the hoodlums of
it.
Yeah. Yeah, he doesn't like us so much.
Okay.
So we gotta keep it really nice and professional with him.
Professional.
Does Mark know who he is or where he lives?
Mark?
He's lived here his whole life.
Can you take us to the constable?
He stands in touch and he goes, yeah, probably. I think I could.
Take us there.
Please.
He just kind of nods dutifully and sets off in a direction without looking back.
I just march after him.
You can see, see in his walk, there's like this sheer determination, like in his step. It's a little bit unsettling almost, because normally he's like by your side and he doesn't really ever want to leave it. And the fact that he is actually taking steps to like lead is a new thing.
Mark, wait up, jeez.
he kind of like slows his pace and does like the little like walk in place until you get close to him. Also, what does Mark look like too? I guess we didn't really establish what he looks like. I know he's a human. He's probably, is he significantly younger than you, or is he, because I know you're like in your 50s.
Oh, yeah.
He's probably like 30.
He's like 20s. And I'm like 50s.
There's a cougar thing.
Like there's cool a cougar boy. Thing happening. But he's like a young gangly thing, just coming into himself.
Big nose.
Yeah, just not quite grown into that yet.
I kind of imagine him with like kind of dark shaggy hair. And,
yeah.
He's got a kind face.
Exactly. Yeah. He's like a simple boy from town. Fell in love with a girl, but now he's in love with me. It's fine.
Right.
Oh no, this got sad.
That's what that love potion
not
was
real
for.
Work.
Oh no, that's right. I
forgot. He screwed it up. Not me.
Baseball.
So, I'm going to still have you roll a survival check, but Mark's going to be assisting you. So, okay. It's like urban survival, essentially.
Urban survival.
Urban survival.
Survival.
Oh, you did.
Unnatural 20.
Ooh, he got a 10. So, he can, yes. Well, you got an unnatural 20. Actually, Mark.
Poor Mark.
He really wants to lead you to where the constable's place is, but he's getting a little lost. He's like kind of looking at street signs. He's doing that thing where it's like the man who won't ask for directions, where he's like, no, I've got it. And he's like looking at the street signs and he's like, it's definitely this way.
Dearie, isn't that the sign over there though?
And he turns around and he's like, that's what I was looking for. That's exactly what I
was
looking for.
I knew it. Let's go there.
So as you guys approach the constable's house, it does look like a more official building, but it's kind of like a white sort of cottage style wood paneled, white wood panels on the front of it. It's got a little bit of an arched black roof. Two white pillars coming down in the front and a brick, a small shallow brick staircase leading up to the door, which has a placard above it that says the constable's full name, which who hasn't given me a name yet? I don't think Molly's given a name yet.
Pemberley, Red Bottom.
Pemberley Redbottom.
Yep.
No wonder we don't like him.
Constable Pemberley Redbottom.
Yes.
It's the most unfortunate last name.
Pemberley Redbot.
Red.
I imagine if he was a halfling,
nobody
he probably
knows.
Would like this
nobody
name, but as a human, it's a little demoralizing. So this man, you can estimate that this guy probably has a little bit of halfling in him, probably a very distant relative, because he's very, very short individual. Kind of unusually short, and he you guys open the door, and this is a one-room establishment. Everything in town is very simple, and so you see, off to the side as you enter, I mean, I'm assuming you enter and do you knock?
Yes.
Okay. So
if that's the normal thing
the
to
stoop.
Do, we do the thing as kosher as possible, like trying to keep it real chill.
Making assumptions, you're kicking the door down. But yes, I would imagine you would want to knock peacefully first. So Gwendolyn knocks very, very quietly, and you see his secretary open the door, and she looks probably you probably knew her. She's probably she kind of like eyes you very quickly. What's this woman's name?
Shirley.
Shirley kind of eyes you quickly. Shirley, the secretary, you guys probably went to grade school together. You probably, it's not that you necessarily didn't get along, but you weren't friendly with each other. You didn't really talk with each other. So it's kind of like going to high school where you're like, I recognize this person, but I don't remember anything about them. And she kind of eyes you. She goes, Gwendolyn?
Shirley, how's the family?
Just fine.
Wonderful. Is the constable in?
He is. Do you have an appointment?
We do not. We just heard about the poor girl last night and wanted to see if we could help out with that.
Only a persuasion check.
Persuade someone. Persuade.
Do it. 13.
13? She kind of eyes you for a moment. She goes, wait here. And she just kind of closes the door kind of abruptly. You hear little, like, clicking inside. You hear, like, the clicking of shoes and a little bit of a discussion. Not a heated discussion by any means, but she kind of, you can tell that there's some sort of conversation happening. A very awkward, like, 5 minutes goes by where you guys are just kind of standing there, like...
Important question. Did we bring Ipo with? Or
I don't know. Did you?
I didn't say
wait,
anything.
She was getting loaded up with all
he's
the
stuff. He's probably
stuff.
Back at
he's
the home.
Fine.
Okay. Well, I just want to make sure.
Should I knock again?
You're just like, where's Ipo?
Where's
Ipo?
I'm trying to punch too,
do
so
we
I'm
hear
not
the
quite
click clacks come back towards the door at all?
Not yet.
That hasn't at all.
Nope.
I rap again, just softly. Just
so there's like you get two knocks in, and you're going in for the third, and the door kind of like shoots open again. She goes,
"Sorry, Shirley. Sorry,
I was getting to it.
No problem.
Right. Are they coming in too?
We'd like to.
If it's
yes, please.
If it's okay. If there's
punching.
Not enough room, we can just take a couple of us. Whatever.
I don't know that there would be enough room.
Constable's okay with.
I'd imagine he'd want to see all of you.
Can he come out here?
No. And she opens the door very slowly and kind of stands off to the side, and you all are escorted. Like, you know, essentially she kind of opens her arm begrudgingly, letting you all into this. And it's a nicer little room. Like, you see it's got a vaulted ceiling, like the cedar beams up top, a nice chandelier. Like, this, it's a simple town in general, but you can definitely see, like, kind of where the money has been spent, and this is one of the nicer establishments. And you see Constable Pemberley, sitting at his desk, and
it's Constable Redbottom to you.
Constable Redbottom, yes. Constable Redbottom is sitting at his desk, and he is a, he's got a bit of a, like, gnomish physique to him, and he's not a gnome, he's a human, but he's got kind of, like, the burly shoulders, very large, he's just compact, he's a compact man. You probably identify with him on a very realistic level, just because your center of gravity is much, much smaller. Yeah, he's a very dense guy. He's got, like, kind of a very unfortunate comb-over going on.
Yes.
And
new ship.
Oh, God, what does this guy sound like?
That would have Pemberley sound.
Oh, goodness. I'm trying to do as snooty English as I possibly can. So he goes, ladies.
And gentlemen,
come in.
Hello.
Hello.
Good morning. First of all, good morning.
He kind of just eyes you. He just
don't know.
You eye him back.
Hello, fine sir. We have come to offer our services to help find the poor baker girl.
Services in what sense?
We would help, like, to search and rescue her if necessary.
Rescue her from what? Who said anything happened to her?
I heard she disappeared in the woods last night.
From whom? Did you hear this?
From a friend of the town. And the rest of the
concerned
town is talking
citizens.
About it.
you might say.
Who hasn't heard about this already?
Exactly. I would imagine people that don't live in the town haven't heard about it already.
Well,
you know, occasionally people come to our hovel to seek aid, and we heard...
Yeah, much to my dismay, they tend to do that, rather than coming to the law enforcement that was set to protect them, but yes.
Well, sometimes things happen that are beyond the explainable, and that's where we come in.
I beg to differ, but how did you all hear about this again? I missed that part. A friend
concerned
who...
citizens within the town. You know, people that have concerns about missing girl in the woods.
Well said.
I thought so.
I feel like more people on this, the better, though. The sooner we'll find her. You need a search party, right?
That's assuming our interests align.
Finding what a would girl's be... pretty a common interest.
Yes. I don't know much about any of you. I remember you, but I don't know much about any of you.
Our interest is to help the town in whatever way possible. We're not looking for anything more than that.
Exactly.
We just want to see that poor little girl get home to a family where she belongs.
Roll me a persuasion check.
Ooh. Unnatural 20.
Oh, you needed that.
Get in, girl!
That was a high DC. You needed that. He kind of, like, you see he, like, is bristling for a second, and he takes, like, a quick swig of something not a mug, but, like, sort of a ceramic sort of container, a cup of sorts. He takes a swig of it quickly and puts it away. Oh, I didn't mention this guy has a mustache, too. He's got a mustache.
Yeah. Is it big and bushy?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Good.
Or is it like half his face? half his face is just mustache.
Good. Moves with him when he talks.
Yeah, moves with him when he talks. He kind of just sighs heartily for, like, you know, this deep, exasperated sigh, and he kind of looks up. He goes, as much as it pains me, I feel that you're right. Maybe more eyes on this might be better.
Thank you.
We got a lot of eyes, so...
Blink, 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 blink.
So, first of all, can we go over what you've found out so far?
Well, first tell me this. You said you want to help, but why? You witches always require some sort of payment.
No.
No.
Certainly not. This girl transcends any sort of payment. You want to help out of the goodness of your hearts. I haven't heard of that
cool
before.
What? Well, that's kind of rude.
Is that not the case? Am I mistaken in this? Because I've...
How about this? I mean, money is not required, but a barter would be very reasonable. Things like food and, you know, milk. We don't grow things, so any kind of tithe is always amenable.
Or a cow. Then we could get our own milk.
And any growth in our relationship for us to grow stronger and into a healthy, more friendly relationship is always helpful.
Yes.
We would love to be able to help you later on as well.
I would much prefer your help if it wasn't of the magical variety.
Well...
We can try to limit the magic part of it. We'll do everything we can without doing magic, and if it comes to a point where it's life or death, we'll only use it then.
I was going to say, I'm going to have you roll a persuasion check and you assist for the cow thing. I want to see if this actually comes to fruition.
I want a cow.
More friends for Jaaldura. He might be on board with that, because then he can just get rid of us again.
Right. He probably doesn't want us to, like, hang around that much.
Yeah, so yeah. If he just gives us a cow,
just takes
away.
A cow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Send him away.
I might need that.
Okay, sorry.
Wait, is this a persuasion? Do I get to
persuasion,
add?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, then I got 10 even. Does that help?
Oh, a 10 would assist, yeah.
Oh, yes.
So you can roll advantage.
I was scared.
Oh.
Put that dice away.
Better dice jail.
I can't use lucky. My halfling lucky, anyway. Yeah, I got a 10. Just a straight
anyways, you're not sure. He kind of gave you guys a look. You're not sure if he has completely written off the idea or if he's considering it. He's hard to read.
Listen, we'd take real good care of a cow. We would. There are things out there in the mist. We all know this, that there are some undesirables.
I'm looking at 5 of them.
Even more undesirable than
that was quick. He's snacky. But our thing is, We live in the mist. We live out there. We're not so, you know, we don't need to wait for it to clear as much. We're used to it. So we could be of help navigating through it. We could be of help, you know,
eliminating some of those other undesirables?
Even if it's just clearing the way for you. So you don't have to deal with that and you can just focus on your investigation.
He considers it for a moment. He kind of, you see him kind of like humming, you know, just...
I do mine too.
You're like,
she wears him.
Quick question. I can like inspire basically by being huge. So when we talked about, yeah, it's my ability.
I'm big. Do you feel inspired?
I do feel inspired. No, but when we're talking about eliminating things in the mist. Like, how does that work? How can I invoke my inspiring by being like, yeah, we'll take care of it? Like,
well, essentially, like that. It's essentially you are imbuing people with the confidence that you could get whatever sort of action done that you. It's how you present yourself, how you speak. So, and just that sense, just how you said it could be
okay
a way to do that.
I want to do that if there's any kind of persuasion now again.
Okay, so go ahead, roll me a d6.
Me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, you.
Yes. So this doesn't work like traditional bardic inspiration, but okay. This is, it's a little bit different, but it should help.
Six.
Nice. So all of you have advantage on attack rolls for one round if you get into combat.
For that first, or for whenever.
Yeah, that was her like bolstering you guys to be able to tackle this. And essentially, you know, doing it in front of the constable to be like, we can keep our shit together and do this.
Right. Right.
Yeah. He considers it for a moment, he's thumbing his mustache, and he sees you doing it, and he stops, like, kind of reflexively, like, very self-conscious of it all of a sudden. And he pauses, and he goes, I would be willing to let you go in by yourselves ahead of time to clear the way for my boys as they come in later after the mist clears. I think that would be agreeable.
Alright.
Do you have any additional information on the girl that Emily...
His theory at this point, he doesn't necessarily have any additional information outside of what Amelia has given you, but he said that as far as he is aware, he's interviewed the parents. She left unbeknownst from the home. They did not know when she left or why. Walked into the mist, and his theory is that she was abducted because the tracks ended. They did manage to go a little bit farther into the forest during the night hours, as far as they were able to without completely getting frightened away. And they did find that the tracks ended, at least as far as he can tell.
Any sign of a scuffle where they stop?
It seems that way.
So there's any other additional bits?
No additional tracks, but has stopped very abruptly.
Listen. Like she just disappeared, or is there like movement around where they stopped?
No movement, but it seems that maybe something came and picked her up. Maybe that's my theory at this point. Is something somebody might have come by and
it wasn't in a clearing or anything. It would have had to be someone within the trees, right?
It was in the forest, yes.
Mm-hmm. But there weren't any other footprints, so maybe it was a giant bird or something. Yeah, that's logical. No, okay. I like your mustache.
Okay. Well, that kind of cuts out the parents. We don't need to talk to them.
True.
We'll leave the town to its business.
Have we had an... Or have you, as the constable, have you noticed any unwanted visitors to town recently? Or people that might be... sketchy. Besides ourselves.
Yeah, he kind of pauses and looks for a second. And
everyone look at the camera.
Let's break that fourth wall.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he kind of pauses for a second. He goes, none other than yourselves, no.
So, what about enemies of the town? Like, has anybody threatened the town or the
What's
people?
What's there to threaten in Watershed? Nobody does anything wrong here. Nobody...
That's right. No one does anything wrong.
Nothing wrong
in the town.
No. Never mind.
Things are quite peaceful.
I'm just trying to find things that we might investigate first, so...
No, so far as I have seen, any sort of danger comes when all of this riffraff
But nobody
comes into
knew,
the equation.
Right? You haven't seen anyone new. We're not new. We're old. We're old news.
I have not seen anybody new.
How about anybody else who's blue?
Other than you two, no.
Well, it wasn't a blue person.
What about
my blue?
direction. So
like a blue-gray.
Blue-gray, yeah.
She went east out of town, right?
Yes.
East, is there any caves or dwellings or empty houses or anything past the woods or past that
There's
area?
There's all manner of things outside in the forest. One such we have not explored. We've stayed within the confines of the town for quite some time, sticking to the past, and that's not on it. So there could be all manner of things.
Okay, so we just have to go check it out, I guess.
I think this is as much information as we're going to get.
Yes.
Yeah. What do you intend to do with her if you find her?
Bring her home. What do you think we're going to do to her?
I don't know.
We take her home.
Yours or here?
Not my house. We only got one room.
We don't have any more space. Mark is enough. I don't need any more people from this town.
My books barely fit. I don't need the 12-year-old.
He still seems very suspicious, and he kind of like cocks an eyebrow in your direction. He goes, but he seems like he's going to leave it alone. Yeah.
Well, anyway, should we be going?
Yes.
Yeah.
Let's get started.
Thank you.
And she leaves.
Thank you so much for your time.
I'm not saying thank you because he thought my blue color
was... Is that in character?
No.
I'm not saying thank you.
I'm just leaving. Goodbye.
Thank you,
I said good day, sir.
Goodbye.
Shirley just kind of like looks up from her tea and she kind of is like...
I'm not talking to Shirley either. Leaving.
Well, she does kind of like wave to Mark on the way out though. And Mark kind of just like, you know, tenuously is like... He doesn't want you to see. He kind of just like, she's going to get mad if I wave at her. He wants to be nice.
Where is the graveyard in conjunction with east?
The graveyard is south.
South of where we are?
It's essentially
south.
The size of this town is, like, for those of you that have played Phandalin, like, The Lost Mines of Phandelver, it's the size of Phandalin. So it's like a Sleepy Hollow-esque town. Mm-hmm. So the graveyard is, like, it's within the confines of the city. It's the whole thing is surrounded by this wood, but it is on the southern side of the community.
So, suggestion, just because of, you know, children now going missing, and the whole hag thing. What if we stopped at the graveyard, took a little detour, and just checked out, you know, the dream bit?
You want to see if there's an eyeball?
Yes.
Well, I also think it's a good idea to talk to the grave digger to see if he's seen anything crawling around at night, too, because I'm sure he's out and about a bit.
He knows stuff.
I'd be fine with that.
I was going to mention, too, so Jaaldura, you said that this young girl had given you bread once before.
Yeah.
No, the rest of you know what she looks like, so I would imagine you probably...
What does she look like? Well, she's a real mousy little whelp, but everybody looks mousy to me. But she's real thin, and she got kind of stringy brown hair in pigtails.
What color are her eyes?
I almost said pink, that's weird. not pink. Well, they're definitely not pink. I'm a little bit colourblind, so grey. they were lighter coloured. It's probably like a grey blue.
So I'm gonna have you roll so it would essentially be a history check, but it would just be remembering something, Molly.
Mm-hmm.
That was cocked.
Wait.
6.
6, nope. Okay. Moving on.
She remembers nothing.
Doesn't ring any bells.
Should have got more sleep last night.
Jaaldura describes to you what was her name?
Emily,
the baker girl, looks like.
Pigtails, mousy, brown hair. Nondescript grayish blue eyes.
Are eyes open?
Graveyard?
Yes.
Okay.
Okay.
Graveyard.
Okay, so you guys go to the graveyard. So, I think, have all of you given me a name? Has anybody not given a name yet?
I think you've all given me a name.
Okay, so who do you think has the best relationship? So the gravedigger is one of your allies.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I was going to assume that it might be Magpie, but so the gravedigger is one of your allies, and he is generally also kind of an outcast in the town. Whereas, like, Amelia and her husband, Amelia and Greg, they fit into the town just fine, and they try to keep your relationship on the DL. The Gravedigger, whose name is...
Antoine.
That's a sexy
name. Are you stealing shiny bits from dead bodies?
I'm not. But Antoine might find some sometimes.
It's fine.
Don't worry about it.
So Antoine is a very lithe older gentleman. He's probably he's probably about 75. He's the older human gentleman, and he is very lanky. He's very kind, but he's also like a little strange. Where you guys are like, he kind of talks in circles sometimes and talks about conversations he thinks you guys have had, but you haven't really. But you guys get along just fine because he does occasionally just be like, so I found this thing. Like, you know, he'll get you little shiny bits every now and again. You're not sure where they came from. You can only assume. You can only assume. He'll just say, yeah, it's so-and-so.
Does any of the rest of us know about this?
Would you even
tell
us? Yeah, no.
Yeah, no, we have no idea.
Nobody knows. It's between me and Antoine.
Every now and again, though, I notice she has a couple more, like, ruby rings. Or, like, oh, there's a new gem on her
yeah,
shawl.
Yeah, the fancy yeah. bits, I think. Like, a couple, like, you once came home with your whole ring finger was, like, four different wedding rings.
Four different wedding rings. Popular night in town.
I doubt you have full husbands, dearie.
I'd say something, but I'm too afraid of men.
Antoine, he's got like silvered hair that he keeps pretty short and like slicked back, and he's got this very Ooh. Like sallow, like, you know, his cheekbones are really pronounced because his face is a little sunken in. His eyes are a little sunken in. They're kind of always like really wide.
He's a good
guy for you to talk to because
I've seen our girl.
You can't miss her.
Weird had this weird image of like hammerhead shark eyes, like kind of on the outside that are just like popping out and like can see an almost 360.
He's not that bad.
Sorry.
Is that like the guy from Young Frankenstein?
Oh god.
Oh god, super no, that's not not quite that bad. He's just like always a little bit like he seems very awake.
He's
like, he's well caffeinated.
He's a
all
real
the time.
Looker.
He He's a good asset for you guys to have in the sense of like being that he is sort of an outcast from the city and being that, you know, his perception is that like everybody's gonna end up in his domain at some point. And so he likes to be a wallflower. He likes to know what's going on in town. He likes to observe very, very quietly. He doesn't have any friends. So he kind of just he's very good about slipping in and out of places unnoticed because nobody really wants to look at him all that much. So he tends to know what's going on in town quite a bit. And he you see him kind of with pickaxe in hand trying to break apart a bit of rough ground. He is he's dug a surprising amount of graves for it being this early in the morning. As you guys approach, you see like he's almost like abnormally tall. Like he's not your level, but he's taller than all of you are by like a good half a foot
well,
at
not
least.
Very big.
Yeah.
No.
He's at least like 6'5". He's unusually tall for a human.
Okay.
And so you see him from behind, like kind of just smacking the dirt, like, you know, with the pickaxe, and he's just like whistling like a very peaceful tune as he's doing this. And it's a little odd, but it seems happy for the most part.
Of course. Antoine.
He kind of like whips around and has the pickaxe in hand, but kind of just like he's like, oh, and he kind of does a little flurry with the pickaxe and kind of like sets it down to the ground. He goes, oh. How are you doing?
Wonderful, and how are you?
I'm doing just fine, thank you.
Have you seen any naked women running around lately?
I'm assuming you're talking about the baker girl.
Yeah. Have you seen her?
I didn't see her this morning, but I have seen her, yes.
Have you seen anything else running around, naked or not?
No, they're naked things, no. She wasn't naked when I saw her either.
Where was she? When was this?
A couple times.
Where?
She came visit
Where?
You?
She didn't visit. I saw her a couple times.
Where?
Here.
When?
In the grave.
In the graveyard?
Yard.
Well, like in town.
You are asking a lot of questions all at once.
Where did you see her?
I saw her twice.
Where did you see her?
Here, and also here.
Great. What time of day did you see her about?
Both in the evening, both here.
In the dark evening?
Yes.
Was it last night that you saw her?
One of the times.
When was the other time?
Every night before that for the last week.
What? Whoa.
She's been coming here.
I've been finding her here. She has not been coming here.
What where does she go? Do?
I found her sleeping.
In the graveyard.
Not just the graveyard. And he kind of points down.
In a grave.
The open ones. Unless it has not been filled
yet.
Does
she have a favorite?
No, she's been moving around. I've been feeling most of them as a deterrent.
So when you see her sleeping in the grave, do you wake her up?
No.
Have you told anybody about this?
Who would I tell?
Parents? She's 12.
Kids seem important.
Right.
Social cues.
So you just...
Roll a thing.
So you didn't wake her up. You didn't...
Did you take her anywhere?
Oh, I didn't.
Was she asleep every time you saw her?
Except for last night, yes.
What was she doing last night?
She walked through. Mm-hmm. I called out to her because she seemed like she was lost. She was looking for something.
Right.
She went over there, she went over there.
Why you got so many graves just preemptively dug?
It was best to get ahead of the curve.
Do you foresee a lot of people dying this week?
This week? Today? Next month? I don't know.
I guess it's good to be ready.
You're good at your job.
Yeah.
So you called out to her. What happened?
She didn't acknowledge. She kept walking. She stopped, she turned, she looked at me. Sort of.
What does that mean?
Did she look past you?
Seemed that way. She didn't have anything here.
So she wasn't looking at something.
She looked like how your eyes are. She looked like that.
Yeah, thank you. Appreciate that.
So no pupil, just white.
It didn't seem like it.
Well, mine are yellow.
Right. Not quite that bad. So white.
Bad?
Let's stay on the subject. Your eyes are pink.
She did not at the time. No, it seemed like she might have been having something in her hand when she first arrived, but I can't remember what she did with it. It didn't seem that way.
Was it bread?
No. Definitively no.
Okay. So, I'd like to look around at the places he kind of pointed at and see if there's anything odd.
That's okay. Roll me a perception check. Okay.
Can I look too?
Yes, you can assist, by all means.
So I just do it normally?
Yep. Can I insight check now?
Sure, the first insight check, I appreciate it.
19.
I got a 12.
You can roll with advantage if you would like, Shelby.
19.
Okay.
And I have an 18 on insight.
18 on insight. Alright, let me look something up real quick to determine what you guys find as far as your perception check is concerned.
Why am I helping my partner?
Yeah, you guys are working together. It's like
I'm very intrigued by what is going on. It seems very scary.
You keep a wide berth.
Oh, no, I'm like helping over here.
You're like peeking over shoulder.
I'm like, let me know if it's awesome. I don't remember where this was in the book, and I feel like I'm going crazy because I remember looking at it and it was not in Volo. I remember it was in. Here we go. Okay, perfect. I just need to read something real quick. I'm sorry. So you got 19.
Yeah.
So you guys take some time to kind of be underground, and you're not finding anything of particular import. You rolling your insight check. What are you trying to discern? He's a very strange guy. He's kind of always got the same expression.
I guess I would. Me as a player is assuming he's being honest. He's just kind of like this, regardless.
Yeah, but it's not unreasonable to think that it's like he doesn't understand social cues.
Oh,
so absolutely.
I have a better thing. I want to see if there's more that he just hasn't told us yet. I don't know if he's purpose. I doubt he's purposefully hiding things, but just is there more to this story that he just hasn't gotten around to yet?
Okay, so you rolled a 18. Oh, yeah, there's more to it. It's not that he's necessarily been covering it up, he just hasn't gotten to it yet because you guys haven't been specific enough.
Just to recap so I understand, you've seen her kind of out and about in the evenings the whole week, but last night, you saw her actually looking around for something here, and then she looked at you, and she did not have pupils, and there was something in her hands. Do you have any idea what was in her hands?
not bread. She's correct.
Did you catch what it was?
I didn't ahead of time, but there's a couple inconsistencies in that story. She wasn't walking around the past couple days. I did find
her. She was in...
She's asleep.
Asleep in the grave, yes.
Mm-hmm.
But she was walking around last night.
Mm-hmm.
And what was in her hand?
I don't know. She was too far away when she had it in her hand. I remember her hand was closed. She went to a couple places. Were there over there now, where they're looking?
And then where did she go?
She went back over there, and he kind of points to the middle of the graveyard where it's kind of like a big open space, and he goes, then that's when I called out to her. I tried to tell her to stop, because mm-hmm. I wasn't sure what she was doing. I thought maybe she was vandalizing something. She turned, she looked, and then she left.
Left to go where? Where did that she way. Head? Does he point east?
Yes.
Okay.
So, did he say that...
I'm not sure what else to ask him.
Yeah, did he say that she had something in her hand and then she didn't have something in her hand?
How big was the thing in her hand? Like, was it
long? Small enough for me not to see it.
Oh, it was like in a fist.
Yes, she had a close fist, okay. And then she had a
did you go look for it when she didn't have it anymore?
What did she do with it?
I don't know. That's why I didn't go look.
Where did she not have it the first time? Like, where did you last see it with it?
Might have been in one of those two places that those two are looking. And so you guys continue to look as you are kind of at the distant. You guys are a good, like, 30, 40 feet away, so you're kind of getting, like, just barely earshot of this conversation as you guys are looking. I'm going to have you roll an investigation check as you come up on the second location, where it looks like some stuff has been disturbed. It looks like something over there has been disturbed.
Can I go over and assist,
someday,
like, after
we're
talking
all
to Antoine? Just to go investigate
seven,
with them.
Six. Okay, you see if you can assist both of
I
these.
I have
yaks.
Really high
I have a plus 5 to mine, so 19.
19, okay, you can, Magpie can roll again.
Natural 20.
Okay.
Yay!
Yay! So first one.
You see for a moment, you kind of come up on the situation where, like, Magpie and Ashes, like, you see both of their, like, butts in the air as they're both digging around. And
my tail's fishing.
Yeah, you see, like, they're oddly close together, and then as you kind of approach, you kind of, like, clear your throat real quick, and then you see Magpie kind of shoot her head up, realize that she's very, very close to Ashes. Ashes realize that he's very, very close to her.
Like,
they
cat.
Kind of migrate away from each other very, very quickly, and then Magpie, you actually, as your hand is kind of brushing over, like, you're getting in there, like, nails and all, and you're just, like, and you see that something, it looks like something has been, like, dropped or deposited back there. You do see a low-hanging tree branch that has, like, a little bit of what looks like sinew sort of tied. And then down by your fingers you feel like a squish, like a really uncomfortable squish.
What's that?
And you see an eyeball.
It's covered up! Covered up! Keep it covered!
I mean, is her fist gonna do that good of a job?
I can't see!
I don't know if I have any.
Pop it. Just squeeze as hard as you can.
Okay, so being that you can
wait. Let's check it out first.
Yeah, being that you can see the eye now, I would say anybody proficient with Arcana?
I do.
Me.
Me.
Nope.
Okay, so all three of you can roll.
Damn it.
This wouldn't be an assist. You guys are just kind of collectively learning.
19.
Pooling your knowledge. 18? 10.
That's a
23. Yeah, 23. 23, okay. So, Ashes, you know the most about it based on your readings. And kind of after Molly kind of called upon this lore from earlier, you recall kind of reading a little bit about it in one of your books. It's a magic item that a hag would craft, essentially. So it's a real eye coated in varnish that is often fitted to a pendant or sometimes left independently. And it can be destroyed. That's the main thing that you realize, is it can be destroyed, but essentially the hag sees through it as if it's her own eye.
Oh.
So she can see anything that it sees. So the fact that it's covered up right now is probably actually a very good thing, because it can't hear. It's not a seeing ear. It's just a seeing eye.
But when I had just lifted it up and we're all like...
Yeah, so you probably... A fisheye lens has seen, you know, if there is somebody watching on the other end...
They definitely saw your face.
Most likely.
And they were probably like, oh!
It can also see... it can see in the dark.
It can see in the dark.
It can see in the dark.
All right, well, I'm going to relay this information.
Is that how you get rid of it?
No, it's magic.
You gotta throw it back in the fiery pit from whence it came.
They didn't make it in a fiery
pit. Fiery eye socket.
It's from a hag. Not a devil.
So how do
you get rid of this? Do I know that?
The 23? I mean, there's all manner of ways you could try and destroy something.
I'm gonna touch my necklace, and I'm gonna summon Beasley. Because okay. He knows a lot of things that I don't know.
Beasley does. Alright, go ahead, roll me a d6 as Beasley shows up this time.
He's got a good weight to him.
Come on, Beasley.
I got one.
Come on. So, okay, fantastic. So Beasley shows up, and he is kind of, like, flitting around your face. He greets you again very, very playfully, but he's like, oh, Ashes, how's it going?
Hi, Beasley.
He kind of, like, zips around your face. He goes, what are we looking at?
I kind of felt, well, I didn't really find it, but Magpie found it, because, you know, she finds a lot of stuff. It's a seeing eye that, like, you know, like, the hags make. We got it covered up now, but definitely saw that ugly mug.
He kind of, like, you see before you even finish the sentence, Beasley kind of comes over and starts kind of, like, nipping at your hand, Magpie, to see if he can get you to open it. He's essentially nipping at your fingers to try and get you to open your hand, because he's trying to look at it. He goes, well, I want to see, and he kind of just, like, flits around for a second, kind of just, like, you know, show like him. A bird, almost.
Yeah, cover up.
Show him.
Just, like, goes in.
Goes in his eyes.
But backwards. So it goes like...
Yeah, so now it's resting in Beasley's eye socket, but backwards. It's just like
a tendon hanging out.
Joke's on us, I can't really see anything.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Well,
okay.
But, okay, did he get a good look at it?
He got a very up close look at it.
Alright. We're going to show it to him, and then we're going
to
cover
show
back
it to
up.
Him again. Oh, we're going to get him a little farther back.
Three, two, one. Okay. He manages to, he goes, oh, and he kind of, he actually, like, exuberantly kind of lifts up when this happens, and I need all three of you to roll me dexterity saves to see if you can keep from him essentially knocking your hand, because he kind of rushes towards it.
Ooh, as, a natural 20. Yeah, natural 20.
Okay. So Magpie is going to be the key here.
12.
Okay, well, I think what happens is he actually does connect with your hand. He actually knocks Molly's hand out of the way, connects with your hand, but then Ash just kind of puts his hand on yours to keep it steady. And then he kind of starts, like, chuckling to himself. Beasley starts, like, chuckling to himself. So he goes, oh, that was a goof. Sorry about that.
Beasley!
I'm just, like, screaming.
So, what do you think about it, Beasley?
You're just touching your hand and crying. What do I think about it?
Yeah! That's why I'm asking you.
I don't know that I have any opinions on it. It's
okay, well, that's great. Any thoughts about how to destroy this? You know,
have you tried squishing it?
It's kind of coated in varnish, so I don't know if it's that squishy.
Tried hitting it. That one has a hammer. Oh, he doesn't point, but he kind of, like, looks in your direction.
Like, gets
well,
in your
actually,
face.
Have a great sword.
He does, actually. No, that's a good point. He does kind of, like, get in your face, almost like a gnat. He's kind of just, like, flitting around your face. He goes, you have an axe, don't you? Try squishing
it. I have a great sword and a halberd.
Good, pointy enough.
Okay, great. Let's maybe
Wait, I have some cloth. And she, like, digs around, because, of course,
yeah,
she's got
just
random bits of fabric.
Please.
1, 2, 3 And I wrap it up in cloth.
Okay.
And I'm
like a burlappy. And I set it on the ground.
Do you think we can track who else who's using this with it?
Ooh. What's a good spell?
Does anyone have identify?
I do.
Or not identify, but like detect magic.
I have that too.
Because maybe we could see if there's like any kind of thread leading back anywhere in particular.
Right, so,
this train of thought. All right. We'll
Ash is gonna reach into his backpack. He's gonna pull out his giant grimoire. And like
Jansport.
Yeah.
What is his grimoire? Being that you're a pact of the fiend or your fiend pact warlock, what is his? His grimoire probably looks a little.
It's nasty looking.
It
so
smells.
It's this giant book that's kind of way too big for him, kind of comically too big.
Found in flesh.
And it's like, God, it's made of this really weird hide that kind of has like spikes on it. And in the center, there's a big closed eye. And so...
What happened?
I
was just trying to check the time.
There's a big closed eye. And so Ash just kind of squats down and he taps... He taps the front cover, and the big eye opens, and it's all, like, green and very scary looking. And so then he cracks it open, and he cracks it open, he's like, hold please, and he's, like, flipping through all the pages.
And actually, Beasley tries to come help you flip through the pages. It's actually kind of getting in your way as you're doing it. He's
Beasley,
kind of, like,
I know where it is! I wrote it myself! God!
You wrote that?
Yeah.
Teach me how to write.
I can't! Yeah. Beasley kind of just still flitting around trying to look over your shoulder.
Beasley! I got it. So,
once he flips to the right page, he will cast Detect Magic.
Okay, so I'm going to have you, based on the fact that this is kind of an abnormal usage of Detect Magic, but I want to see if you can get as much bang for your buck as possible, I'm going to have you roll an Arcana check just to see kind of what, because you guys are trying to use it to track, essentially. Is that my understanding?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
So Arcana.
Yep. Go ahead, roll Arcana.
Four. This doesn't work, I have another idea.
Plus four is eight.
Plus four is eight. You can also use a table denter if you want, so.
Table denter! Did we explain to the people at home?
We didn't explain the table denter, we also kind of haven't explained it to Kalyn. So this is a homebrew rule that we use in my game and Anna's game, is that you roll this magical big die, this big d20, in place of one roll. It's essentially like a luck die. You get to, if you mess up a roll that you thought was really important, you get to roll the table denter once per day, and you have to use whatever that thing tells
you.
Okay,
do you think it's worth rolling on this?
I actually have another idea for how we might see where this thing came from.
Yeah, okay. You can hold on to it if you
but
want.
But, like, that was an Arcana check. That wasn't me actually casting the spell, was it?
The spell gets cast regardless. This was just to see how much bang for your buck you get out of it.
Okay. I don't know. What do you guys think? Is it worth rolling?
I think it's your choice. We might get something useful out of it.
Or you might be dying later on and need it then.
I'll stick with an eight.
Okay, stick with an eight. You do detect that it is, the school of magic thing always throws me for a loop. I'm not entirely sure what school of magic it would be. I'm assuming the same as, like, whatever a teleportation circle would be. Whatever that one is, I'm not sure. But essentially, this thing, I mean, what you do detect is that, it is definitely a magical item. It is constructed. It can be destroyed through non-magical means.
Non-magical. Okay.
Oh, we might actually be able
it's
to
created
just
through a ritual,
smash it with a hammer.
Well, yeah. I mean,
I don't have a hammer.
I do.
Shay has a hammer.
More hammer.
How about Jesus. We just step on it, Jaaldura.
Wait,
a fat joke.
I might be able to.
No, it's a big foot joke.
I might be able to see some kind of link or where it came from.
Okay.
Would it be possible to use my Cat's Cradle, like,
yes,
soothsayer ability on it?
Yeah, totally.
Just to see, like, if I could trace any kind of link back to its original owner or to its past, like, where it came from.
Okay, so this will be an interesting point to bring up, the corruption stuff. So, essentially, so Molly takes a step back, and I didn't bring the yarn, unfortunately, but
I forgot it,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, I know, we don't have any yarn. It's for
well, I have
knitters. Yeah. So Molly, essentially, she whips out this, like, long string of what color yarn?
It will just be kind of like a green.
Green? Mm-hmm. So she whips out this long string of green yarn and kind of, like, wraps it around her hands and intricately kind of pulls it taut, and it has this pattern throughout it as she's holding it in her fingers, and she actually pulls it taut in front of her face, looking upon the tree in which this eyeball was once held. So you can choose to roll off the chart, as everybody else has been doing, and kind of take what comes, or you can take a point of corruption and see specifically what you would like. Because you are essentially manipulating what you see. How badly do you want to know what was there?
My curiosity. I'm gonna roll off the chart.
Okay, D6,
because
please.
We haven't even started. We haven't hit like a end of our rope. Like we haven't. The trail hasn't gone cold
right
yet. We still have more things to explore.
True.
And I feel like she wouldn't take that risk quite yet.
Okay.
D6.
Mm-hmm.
Three.
Oh, okay, perfect. This actually works out quite well. So you see, you do see a young girl with pigtails.
I see her. I see Emily.
What's
all
she
you see, you see her from behind. You see her tie something to the tree, and then walk away.
She left this here.
It does look. You can see the eye kind of it's suspended, but it seems like it is fairly secure.
Can I follow Emily at all beyond this? Or am I just locked in?
No,
this
you
moment?
Can hear, you can follow her a little bit. It'll be finite. You won't get it for very long, but you do see you follow her for a minute and you see that this doesn't look like it was like actually roll me a remembering check. So just a basic intelligence check.
11.
It rained a couple days ago, and it's raining in this, what you see. It's raining quite heavily. So it wasn't last night.
This eye was here since 2 days ago. It was raining. It rained 2 days. Mm-hmm. So she left this here, not last night, but the night before. She must have... She came back for it.
Do we know that?
She had it in her hand.
But she left it.
Last night. But yeah, she left it.
But why did they... Why did she put it here in the first place?
Yeah, it's just the graveyard. Unless, you know, Anton.
Maybe she likes Anton.
Who the heck?
Well, I don't know.
Anton.
Maybe not.
Did you ever notice an eyeball hanging from the tree?
Should I have?
Probably.
Maybe, I mean, I suppose you see kind of a lot of things.
Did you, though?
No. Not to my knowledge. Great.
Have any eyeballs gone missing for...
Some gone missing, some gone missing.
How often?
What?
Twice a week. Give or take.
Wait, what? People have been taking eyeballs out of the graveyard?
Can you know that?
Yes or no, Anton?
Anton, you
this
just...
This is not an answer.
This is kind of your thing, man.
I don't know.
Okay.
Do other people come here?
Yeah, have you seen anyone else?
To
pick things.
Just Emily.
Right.
But you've noticed... Eyeballs missing from deceased people in the graveyard lately.
Mm-hmm. Have you told the constable?
No.
Why not?
Same reason we don't tell the constable.
Don't tell him anyway.
This other body part is missing.
Do you find important?
Yes.
Conversations.
Great.
Good, because you're good at them.
So, hold on. How many eyeballs?
Total,
that you have personally known came missing.
Six.
Ooh,
six eyeballs.
That's a lot.
Wait, no, there's five.
Yeah. Well, unless you want to count Mark. Mm.
I think it's safe to say that hags are definitely interested in Watershed, and we should find out what's going on immediately.
And keep an eye out for these things.
Because that's incredibly dangerous.
Disadvantage.
No.
So I... Tiefling. Ashley looks over at Beasley and goes, hey, so six eyeballs? That's kind of a lot of eyeballs. You ever heard anything like this? Hags? Demons? Something?
Oh, a little bit here and there, yes.
Okay, well, like, what little bit?
That they use eyes to see through? I imagine she's probably collecting something.
But you only think it's one hag? For six eyeballs?
I'd imagine if there were three of them, we would have noticed.
That's true.
Two eyeballs per each.
Oh.
That's gotta hurt your head when you're looking at two different things at the same time.
I don't want to think about it that much.
I'm more worried about where the other eyeballs might be.
Come to think of it, Anton kind of like pipes up at this point. Come to think of it. The girl wasn't here for 5 days, she was here for six. That's interesting.
So she's probably the one taking the eyeballs, right?
Yeah.
Mm. But why is she sleeping in the graves?
And where is she leaving the rest of the eyeballs? You have not... Have you seen any other eyeballs
anywhere
around?
Not just here.
Anywhere in town. This is important.
Yeah.
Please remember.
I will remove the question of whether or not it is important. It is important.
It's very, actually.
Let me think. He kind of pauses for a second. Let me think. Ooh. He kind of pauses for a second, and he actually calls out five specific locations within town.
Antoine, I swear to God.
And those places would be?
One is the bar.
Greg's bar?
Greg's bar at the upper part. He doesn't know about the cellar, so
it's in the actual bar.
One is the constable's quarters.
Oh, great.
What was he doing in there?
One is
He's just in the background in every shot.
He's like what's that tall skinny man that's in pictures all the time?
Slenderman.
Slenderman.
He's Slenderman.
out of this campaign.
One was in the morgue, like where the mortician's quarters are. One was in the chapel.
Chapel.
Great, all the places where people just love us.
And he says one was in like outside on the eastern side of town, like outside of a house.
What side is hovel?
Western.
Does
Western.
He know whose house it is, or just a house?
That's a house.
Great, a house.
Wait, whose house though? Important. Remember, important.
Well, he did do pretty good. So he goes, I don't have to think of it. It might have been the baker's house.
Okay.
The guests from downtown.
That's
like
just
a plain clue.
That just gave me like the heebie-jeebies, like legitimately of like. they're watching us everywhere.
And so
yeah.
You'd never kind of interacted with these eyeballs, did you, Antoine? You didn't touch them? Did you go up to them?
No.
You didn't think about grabbing them and putting back in the bodies where they belong?
Do they belong there?
I would assume
this
so.
This is a question. This is a very, like, high-level question.
This is getting into ethics.
Philosophy.
They're not actually in the body anymore.
Yeah.
Does the body need to be fully together?
So, you saw all these eyeballs, do you know if they're still there? When was the last time you saw them?
Probably yesterday.
Probably yesterday.
So, it's probably-
We need to go get them.
Yeah, we should probably-
Let's go collect
them. What about Emily Baker?
I think these eyeballs might take us to Emily Baker.
I think we should get make sure the town isn't being spied on first and then go after it.
Well, it's definitely being
maybe
spied
we gather
on.
Them
I
into
do
like
have
a little
worry
eyeball
that
bank.
We did say we would clear the way for the consul.
Oh, yeah.
And we've been here and not clearing the way for the constable.
How long has it been?
Oh, it's been a good hour and a half.
Because frickin' Anton can't give it to
you. Yeah, well, Amanda, did answer us.
You're lovely.
It's okay, Antoine.
Sorry.
I know it's your thing.
I know it's okay.
So,
it's his thing, man.
Do we want to try and
maybe
grab some?
Let's
on
go
the way
split
out.
Up and grab them.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Split.
Well, I think some of these are going to be a hard pass. Constable's quarters, I don't think that's happening, and probably not the bar, at least not for, you know.
Maybe the constable's can leave there.
Those of us who are blue are kind of good.
Are there people on the way, or are a few of these buildings on the way?
The Eastern House definitely is, if you guys are going to the east. That's the
yes.
Baker's house.
That's probably
is the bar close by there? I forget.
The bar is on the western side of town. So
yeah, that's closer to where we're from.
Would we want to tell the constable about where these eyeballs are? So,
do you think he's going to believe us if we tell him there's an eyeball in his room?
Maybe if we show him the eyeball, well, no, he'll think
we have to get in there.
Eyeball.
Well, for sure.
I hesitate to involve him more than we already have. That's true. And if we need to prove something to him later, we can just be like, then what's that? And point out the eyeball hanging in his office.
Ooh, good moment later.
Do we know if it's hanging? It might be in a fishbowl.
I'm just saying, we can point out the weird dismembered body parts sitting in his office.
True. So what about the morgue? Are we going to pass that on our way towards...
You would pass the morgue.
Wait. Antoine. Have any ears gone missing? Or is it just eyeballs?
Two in the last 2 months.
Two ears?
2 months.
So...
keep your eyes open for ears.
I would say that they were pecked off, not taken.
Should we also keep ears open for eyes?
Ears open for eyes.
However you decide to search.
Right, okay, I think we should probably maybe head east.
Mm.
If we can grab an eyeball. That's probably preferable.
Yeah. At least the Baker house eyeball.
So
there's nothing else on the way.
Oh.
Okay.
How do we get rid of the current eyeball?
Oh right. We kinda gotta smash that up. Jaaldura, you think you got that?
Yeah, I got it.
Alright, roll me an attack.
Please don't roll.
We set it's still in like the cloth.
Yeah, it's in
the
cloth.
It's in the cloth, I guess, setting it down.
Yeah.
I'm gonna
and
take out
the
execution
style.
I'm gonna take out my halberd.
Okay. There we go.
Oh yeah. Okay. So that's a 19 to hit the eyeball.
It absolutely hits.
Okay.
Roll damage. Let's see how much overkill you do on this little eyeball. With your d12 or whatever the hell you roll.
It's a d10 plus 4. Oh, that's not great. 6.
Still, it squishes very satisfyingly and just kind of like across the ground.
One down, 5 to go.
Let's go.
Okay.
Otherwise, the constable's gonna be after us, I'm sure.
Right.
Yeah.
We did tell him we'd do a thing.
Thanks so much, Antone. Don't let any more body parts go missing.
Right.
And if you see any that do go missing, let us know.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's not very convincing.
No, I'm not convinced either.
You see, yeah, you saw the eyes kind of dart back and forth as he was, like, kind of considering it for a second, and he kind of just, like, goes...
Alright, great. Baker House, then the woods.
Okay, yep. So this is a good time to take a break, because it is 3 o'clock for us. So we're going to take a quick, like, 15-minute break, so you guys in chat, go get a drink, go to the bathroom, and then we will come back, and we'll start off with you guys heading toward the eastern side of the forest, gathering eyeballs. So hang tight, guys. We'll be back in just a little bit, 10-15 minutes, probably, at the lowest, I would say.
See you in a bit.